Wilson? Wilson? How many times do I have to tell you not to say hello on the telephone? Announce yourself, officially. This is HQ, number one company, B platoon, Warmington on sea, home guard. And you are platoon sergeant Wilson.
Yes, right. This is HQ, number one platoon, V company, Warmington on sea, home guard. And this is platoon sergeant Wilson speaking, yes. Oh, hello. Nice to hear from you again. It has been such a long...
Would you all mind falling? Be relaxed, please. Just as quickly as you can. Thank you so much. In three nice, neat lines. That'll be absolutely lovely. Thank you so much.
I think he was perfectly cast as Sergeant Wilson. I don't think anybody else could have done that. Anybody in the world could have played Sergeant Wilson like John did. It was John.
Oh, yes, that's awfully good. It's all... Oh, yes, it's all sparkly. You know, it's just like fairyland, sir.
The thing about John is he had an enormous sense of fun. I think people perceive him as a sort of authority figure, but actually he was very playful and very naughty.
Wilson,
thank you so much.
Wilson.
Most kind of you. Thank you very
Wilson.
Much.
Wilson.
I'm sorry.
John LeMessurier was best known for his portrayal of Sergeant Wilson in Dad's Army. He grew up in the prosperous town of Bury St. Edmunds in Suffolk. After a public school education, John was expected to follow in his father and grandfather's footsteps and pursue a career in law.
He was brought up in a sort of Betchamesque countryside, you know. When he was very young, he was out with his nanny and he saw a crowd of people coming out of the local theatre. And they were very flamboyant and dressed up, and the women wore lots, far too much makeup, but he just thought they were gorgeous. And he said to Nanny, "Who are those people, Nanny?" And she said, "Those are theatricals, Master John, and you must have nothing whatever to do with them, ever."
But John never forgot the theatricals, and when he was 21, he abandoned law and finally pursued his dream to become an actor. After a brief stint at drama school, his career began in repertory theatre.
He was divine, absolutely stunning. You know, he had blue-black hair, beautiful dark eyes, incredibly good-looking. People pined away for him. I mean, there was one girl who really got quite thin. I'm sure she was taken off to be a nun instead of be staying there with what John was about. I think he possibly knew that he had this great charm.
John was a ladies' man. They all adored him. I mean, he was very attractive to ladies.
You either got it or you ain't. And John LeMessurier had it.
Just before the Second World War, John began working with theatre director June Melville. They fell in love and were married in 1939. By the end of the war, June's alcoholism had destroyed the marriage. And in 1947, he met actress and comedienne Hattie Jakes. John and Hattie had two sons and had been married for 10 years when she fell in love with a younger man.
She told John, she said, "John, you know, I'm terribly sorry, but..." okay. And they all lived in the same house.
He just carried on his own sweet way, had a few drinks and didn't make a big fuss.
Most men would have just gone straight off to a hotel or something. No, but I don't think that occurred to him.
I mean, the idea of looking for a flat, John couldn't do that. He wouldn't know where to go.
His sadness was really overwhelming at times. His heart was broken, really broken, by Hattie. He really loved her.
He must have been hurt so much, but he never showed. It was the thing that they were, I suppose, taught at that time. That, you know, an Englishman never shows his emotions. That's how John was. He never showed emotion.
That same year, on November the 10th...
John and Hattie's breakup was not public knowledge when This Is Your Life featured Hattie. Never get up. Her new lover watched from the wings.
So there's never a dull moment with Hattie, in fact?
No, there isn't, really. I would like to say that I am eternally grateful to the way she runs the home,
looks after the children, looks after me. The home comes first, really, if I'm right in saying. I think for somebody who is so busy all the time and so much in the public eye all the time, to do all these things is very difficult and a jolly neat trick.
Thank you, John de Messier.
Luckily, I was there like a sort of, should I say, cushion to break the fall, and we became great friends, and it was, 18 months before anything deepened between John and I, but in the meantime, I was the person who there and tutted to him.
Joan was 20 years younger than John. She'd previously been married to the actor Mark Eden, and together they had a son, David. They were still close, and it was through Joan that Mark and John became friends.
John was just this lovely gentleman, and I felt for him eventually. It certainly wasn't love at first sight.
But in 1966, John and Joan were married.
When John proposed to me, I didn't know I was being proposed to. It was in a restaurant called Grumbles, which was very good, very, you know. And he said, I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't suppose you'd take me on for a start. And I didn't realise that was a proposal of marriage until quite a long time afterwards. When I married John, he just turned his life over to me. His bank account was sort of my responsibility. He was a man who was totally without greed or malice or jealousy. He hadn't got those emotions in him.
Any subject? Really?
Yes.
You know a lot of subjects. You know a lot of subjects.
Yes, I do. Well.
Do one of those confident ones in a posh voice.
Yes, in a posh voice.
Yeah. Go on.
Yes, well,
John's angle on humour was very, very subtle. You know, little things would really tickle him.
Because I remember it now. Somebody told me the other day about a fellow who had a racehorse. And he was on pretty good terms, this racehorse, with his jockey.
Lovely talker, isn't he?
Yes.
Lovely.
And he used to have a lot of quite animated conversations together, these two. And the jockey said to the racehorse one day, he said, now look here, unless you win this race tomorrow, you'll find yourself on a milk run the following day. Yeah.
Interruption by Joe Brown.
Oi.
Yeah?
I've just told it, right?
See, that's where I heard it.
Six years later, on a tour of Australia, John collapsed and was flown home. He was diagnosed with liver failure. John LeMessurier died on November the 15th, 1983. He was 71.
Almost the very, very last thing he ever said to me before he went into a coma was, it's all been rather lovely. Not bad. He said to me, will you promise me that when I die you will put in the Times, in the obituary column, John LeMessurier conked out, because it always made him laugh. Snuffed it and conked out, because he used to hate it when they said he's gone with the angels and he's departed this life. He hated all that. And it had the most amazing impact. It was on all the billboards that night. Dad's Army Star conks out. Tell them I conked out, said Dad's Army Star. You know, John LeMessurier conked out. And it just went, it's gone into famous last words.
As somebody said, considering really he was not a star, he was a supporting actor always. He got, well, the obituaries were just, I mean, they were so huge. I mean, you would have thought that a major star had died. Because everybody felt they knew him and loved him.
He was a gentleman, a real gentleman. In fact, he was a one-off.
That's his epitaph. He was one of the last of the gentleman actors.
Well, there it is.
I hope you'll have enjoyed some of the stuff. At least it's a bit different.
Guten Abend, Freunde. Guten Abend. Und vielen Dank für ein so herzliches Willkommen. Und es tut mir leid für mein schlechter Deutsch, aber in Deutschland besser schlechter Deutsch als gut Englisch. Ne? Ich nehme nur eine Minute vor, meinen Kollegen zu präsentieren. Und ich bin ganz stolz hier. Sie sind einige die Beste in der Welt. La Crème de la Crème, man sagt. Oh ja, la crème de la crème. And the bass, Etienne Mbappé, Etienne Mbappé. Und mein Freund hier, er spielt Klavier so fantastisch, aber eine Minute. Schlagzeug. Ha, so ein Wort. Drums? Nein, Schlagzeug. So ein super Wort. Und ein super Schlagzeuger. Mit Klavier und Schlagzeuger Gary Husband. Und der Monster, der Schlagzeuger, ein alter Freund, wir vor 10 Jahren jetzt spielen. Er ist aus Indien, aber so ein Schlagzeuger in unser Stil. Und ich bin so glücklich, ihn zu haben heute. Ranjit Barot, der Schlagzeuger. Oh ja, super. Und so, wir spielen jetzt ein Stück und das, wir haben die beiden aufgenommen vor 6, 7 Jahren auf einer CD, Floating Point, und das Stück heißt Abaji.
understanding. Love and understanding. Love and understanding now. Love and understanding. Love and understanding. Understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding,
love and understanding,
love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding, love and understanding. Love and understanding.
Love and understanding.
Love and understanding.
Love and understanding.
Love and understanding.
Love and
understanding. Nicht nur Schlagzeuger, aber Sänger auch.
Ranjit Bharat.
Thank you.
Gary Husband.
Thank you. Daddy, you're not gonna die. Daddy, you're not gonna die. Daddy, you're not gonna die.